بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على رسوله محمد وعلى آله وصحابه أجمعين أما بعد فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم ألف لام ميم ذلك الكتاب لا ريب فيه هدى للمتقين وقال تعالى وما خلقت الجن والإنس إلا ليعبدون وقال تعالى ألم نجعل له عينين ولسانا وشفتين وَهَدَيْنَاهُ النَّجْدَيْنِ. So my dear brothers and sisters, inshallah this course for 2 days, it is just to help us how to understand the Qur'an. You know, people make effort to understand any text or any writing or any speech in the world. But when it comes to the Qur'an, we Muslims, we don't make much effort to understand the Qur'an. And very often what actually happens is people listen, hear one verse from the Qur'an and then they start thinking and to give it a meaning from their own, you know, knowledge, you know, what they have got before, you know, from the society, from any, from their own background. They never think, let's read in the Qur'an what Allah wants from this, you know, from this word, what the meaning is there, what in the context, and what actually, how this word has been used, you know, more than once in the Qur'an. Instead of finding the meanings of the words from the Qur'an or meanings of the statement from the Qur'an, people find the meaning from somewhere else. For example, if the people are, you know, influenced by the madhahib, so if I'm Hanafi or Maliki or Shafi or Hanbali, any verse of the Qur'an comes, I would like to understand in the light of my own affiliation to a madhab. If I follow certain theological school like Ashari, Maturidi, Mu'tazila, so I want to give meaning to the Qur'anic verse from my own background. So, you know, there are so many, you know, if I follow philosophy, I follow this, I follow that, people actually, so you can see same verse of the Qur'an, if you look, it has been understood so differently from each, from the people, it looks like contradicting. So one wonders, does Qur'an have a meaning or not? And if Qur'an has a meaning, if it does not have meaning, fixed meaning, then how Qur'an can be guidance? And how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says all the time, Qur'an is a clear Arabic language. Qur'an has come to explain to the people, guide to the people. If the Qur'an does not have any fixed meaning and people can interpret the Qur'an as they want and there is no meaning, so how can we guidance? So this actually is very important to understand. Does really Qur'an have a meaning or not? When Allah has conveyed the message, did the Prophet understood the Qur'an properly or not? When he conveyed the message, did his companions understood the book or not? You know, we have to try to understand. Because, and if they understood and our understanding goes against them, so who is more right? Is the Prophet more right or we are more right? So many of these questions should be coming to our mind. So before, inshallah, in Ibn Taymiyyah, no doubt, this Muqaddimah, it is small Muqaddimah, but really, you know, very comprehensive in helping people to understand the Qur'an. And because I started writing commentary and it took me more than 3 years now, still doing, but alhamdulillah, you know, for that I read, you know, his writings in Fatawa everywhere, so many times and so many things, it really helping me to understand what he means. Because sometimes he says one sentence, if you don't look properly what he means, it is very, it's not easy to understand what he's trying to say. Because, you know, man is actually, you know, amazing knowledge and a very deep person and a good, you know, analysis. So we have to understand him properly. But before that, I just want to, you know, start with the verse of the Qur'an, which everybody quotes. Let's try to understand what this verse means in the Qur'an itself. You know, you can find Imam Ghazali has written the whole book on this verse, Mishkatul Anwar, what does it mean? So I'll come to that, actually, that, you know, this is really what Ghazali is offering. Is it really what Qur'an said? But first I want you to go through the Qur'an, see really what Qur'an said. Then look what Ghazali said, then look what Razi said, then look what everybody else said about the verse. You know, this is very important. Respect, you know, we should have respect for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We must have respect for his book. You know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala cannot send guidance which cannot help us to guide. It's impossible. You know, it is not a puzzle. It's not a mystery. It is a clear book, very, very clear book. It has come to help people. It has not come to keep people in darkness. You know, the way that people interpret the Qur'an, it means the Qur'an has no meaning. So, and that I'm trying to say first, practically, theoretically, what this verse means, and then inshallah, you know, I'll come to explain the Muqaddimah of Usul Tafsir. This verse is from Surah An-Nur. We have written properly there because the reason is because I'm going to spend a little bit more time on this verse. So I want to explain because many people are taking any meaning of this verse. So there, this is from Surah An-Nur. And the verse is, from, you know, in Surah An-Nur, verse number 35 to 40. So like six verses, 35 to 40. So now see in this verse what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is trying to say. In this verse, in these three few verses, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given three examples. Yeah, three examples have been mentioned in this, you know, this Surah An-Nur. I have mentioned number one. First one, very long. The first one is said, Allahu nuru samawati wal ard mathalu nur. Three examples are mentioned. One example is very long one, then the second one, third one. First example start with the Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saying mathalu nurihi kamishkatin. The example of Allah's light is like mishkat. So this first example. The second one is وَالَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا أَعْمَالُهُمْ كَسَرَابٍ. You know, those people, you know, who are unbelievers, the example of their actions. So that's the second example. The third one is كَالْغُلُوبَاتٍ فِي بَحْرٍ لُجِّيٍ, like darkness in ocean, in a sea. You can see the first example and the last one, they have very much similarity. So in the first example, you can see, light, upon the light. So in Arabic language, when you repeat something twice, it does not mean only two. It means many, many times. For example, if I have a lot of bananas here, and I ask someone, give to the people two, in Arabic language, it does not mean only four. It means give two to each one. So I say two, it means, many. To this person, repeating means to give everybody two and two. So when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, Noor ala Noor, light upon the light, meaning it, it's not only one light, there are layers of the light. So happening it. And actually that example given to anyway, the first one basically is, where you can see the light, and light is not one layer, light upon the layer, upon the light, upon the many, many layers. Last example is same thing. Darkness, many, many layers, not only one layer. Darkness, more than one. Darkness of the unbelief. You can see Bahari Lujin, ocean, wave upon the wave. And then also the cloud. That's only one. Quran says, there's a ghulumatun ba'duha fawqa ba'd. Darkness, part of each upon the other. Means darkness upon the darkness going on. And this is first one, you start with the noor, light. And then again, last one end. So you can see the whole three examples start with the light and ends with the light. So the first one is light, and then light says, وَمَنْ لَمْ يَجْعَلِ اللَّهُ لَهُ نُورًا فَمَا لَهُ مِنْ نُورٍ. Anybody for whom Allah does not make a light, he has no light. From these examples, it should become very clear to the people that the example here is given not about Allah, that how Allah is. Example is Allah's light and Allah's darkness. So Allah is the creator of the light, and he is the creator of the darkness. This light that he has mentioned here is light of the guidance, light of Iman. And darkness that he's mentioning is darkness of the kufr. If you read the Quran, this verse becomes very clear. So the first example basically is example of the light of the Iman, light of the belief. What is the example of the light of the belief? And then the second one is the وَالَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا أَعْمَالُهُمْ, example of the actions of unbelievers. Unbelievers, when they do action, the actions have no value. So like if you are in the desert, the sand, so much sand, and you are thirsty, you want water. So you see, from the far distance, as water is shining. When you come there, it's not water. So, that's how the unbelievers are. They do the actions, so much hard work, and they think they have achieved something. But when they will come to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, nothing is there. They did not achieve anything. So second example is actions and deeds of the unbelievers. And the third example is the unbelief itself, kufr. So basically, we can say there are four things people should know. The first one is the true knowledge, al-ilm al-haq, the true knowledge. And the second thing is al-amal al-salih. When you have true knowledge, then righteous action depends based on the true knowledge. People have got there's true knowledge and then righteous action. Then the third thing is darkness of dark ignorance. So opposite of the opposite of the knowledge is ignorance. So the third thing is ignorance. And the fourth thing is the bad deeds bad actions which actually based on the darkness. Or maybe in Arabic we can write to al-ilm al-haq, first one. The second one is al-amal al-salih. And then the opposite of them, the third one is al-jahl al-mudhlim, the dark ignorance. And the fourth one is al-amal al-batil al-sayy, the false evil action. Four things are there. Examples are only three. Examples have been mentioned for the al-jahl al-mudhlim, the last one, you see, al-jahl al-mudhlim, the dark ignorance. Then examples also have been given for the false action, that is the second example, وَالَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا أَعْمَالُهُمْ. So for the opposite one, two examples are there. Examples of the dark ignorance and example of the actions of unbelievers. The first one, actually only one example, and that's Iman. Because Iman basically is such a thing, it's so much detail. It includes the right knowledge and right action together. Allah SWT put them so nice, because you can see examples go on about the Iman action both. Like for example, رِجَالٌ لَا تُلِهِهِمْ تِجَارَةٌ وَلَا بَيْعٌ عَنْ ذِكْرِ اللَّهِ وَإِقَامِ الصَّلَاةِ وَإِتَاءِ الزَّكَاةِ. So in the first example, Iman and Amal. You can say true ilm and pious action both have been combined. When example came for unbelievers, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala divided. You know, one is example of their action and one example of their ignorance.